Well, I think sometimes people say, well, what on earth, what business have you got telling us your opinions? Why should anybody care about your opinions more than about anybody else's? And one of the reasons for that is that I've been out.
Yes.
I've been abroad. I've been into the sort of circumstances we've described. And therefore, however stupid and dismal I may be, I have picked up a certain amount of knowledge which most people don't have, and it's quite useful to me.
It is. But still, let's look at what actually did happen, because you were quite rightly going about your business as one, a citizen of this nation, but also as a journalist. You went to observe day three or whatever it was of the Cecil Rhodes demonstration, and I read with some interest yesterday that they're now thinking of replacing Cecil Rhodes' statue with a statue of a black student who went to Oxford on a Cecil Rhodes scholarship in 1907. It seems to me that we've reached kind of, you know, Alice in Wonderland status here.
Well, it's complicated. I mean, I'm not going to stand bail for Cecil Rhodes, who had a lot of things wrong with him, though many of the things that are said about him are also probably exaggerated too. It's not, for me, I think it's an ugly statue on an ugly building of a complicated man who was a mixture of good and bad, the good mainly being the philanthropy he did later. But I don't want to get involved in that. I think I pretty much knew by the time I went on that demonstration that the college was likely to back down, because that's the way the establishment is at the moment. If they're threatened, they back down. It's the bizarre, almost revolutionary situation in which we are.
Yes,
in which
but your presence,
conservative, just goes.
But your presence at that demo was what caused the fuss, right?
Well, that's one way of putting it. I'd been present at the demonstration for some time. I'd followed them up from the High Street round into St Aldate Street and then along a bit for about, I suppose, half a mile. And I'd been chatting to some of the demonstrators, in most cases, in a perfectly friendly fashion. But I think they got bored because the route of the march was too long.
Right.
And one of them, a guy I'd never seen before, quite older than most of them, very gaunt character, spotted me and started glaring at me. And then he started up this chant. Mm. And because we were going around corners at the time, and because the person filming me, who I don't think was a friend of mine, was filming me filming me from the front, it looks much more as if they're coming up behind me than what was actually happening, which was that I was walking on the pavement and they were walking on the road. And it is, how shall I put it, it's a novel experience having people chanting your name in a hostile way quite close to you.
Yeah. It must be, because it must be quite unsettling. I mean, you look, as I said, very, very insouciant as you were walking. And I thought...
Nice you say so.
Well, yeah. I thought rather stylish, actually. But, I mean, the funny thing is it must... although you say you felt more threatened by a group of hamsters, you might...
Hamsters could be terrible.
I'm sure, yeah. A gerbil on your finger, if that bites you, terrible.
Yeah, goodness. Damaged by a guinea pig is bad.
Too. Yes, but, I mean, it must have been unsettling, at least.
Well, look, I have other experiences that people don't have. I used to go on demonstrations myself when left-wing ideas were actually a good deal less popular than they are now, and when we hadn't won. And we were a lot rowdier. And one of the things I took up station, the place where I got interrogated by one of the marchers, was very close to Rhodes House in Oxford, I thought, which is towards the end of the route of the march. I thought maybe some of them would make a break for it. And I have to say, in my day of demonstrating, that would almost certainly have happened. Mm. People would have. But I have a strong suspicion a lot of the marchers didn't even know that Rhodes House, which is the headquarters of the Rhodes Scholarship, was even called Rhodes House or was there. I didn't know they were walking because they knew so little about it. But these marchers were actually much more passive and flaccid than we ever were.
Yeah.
In my left-wing marching days, I got a quite considerable melee in Grosvenor Square in March 1968, for instance. They were, at one stage, I actually noticed them going up to the police and saying, could the police help them deal with a drunk who was following them around?
Yeah.
Which is, you know,
well, it's sort of middle class. It's very middle class, this revolution.
It is middle class,
it?
But it's not just that. It's the establishment on parade. It's a sort of religious procession rather than a protest.
Yes.
And what these things do is they provide the pretext for the left-wing people in places like Oriel College to say, well, look, there's a big protest about this. We want to bring it to an end. Let's make concessions.
Mm.
Same with the anybody in Bristol who, in official circles, who might have wanted the Colston statue to come down. They might also have been quite glad to have the pretext of a mob pulling it down and say, well, it's obviously got to go now.
Yes.
What these demonstrations do is they affirm in the establishment the general moves to the left, whereas when we were doing it, we were trying to get people to become left-wing when they weren't, and that's a wholly different thing.
And you were genuinely...
One of the reasons
yeah.
I wasn't bothered is because I know what demonstrators alike, and that kind of demonstration doesn't frighten me.
No, sure. But I guess the next question then is, when does it end? Because I've asked this to people. In fact, I had somebody on a couple of weeks ago from Black Lives Matter, and I said, when do your marches end? What is your aim? And when do you realise that you've reached your aim? And basically he said, well, we'll never reach our aim. We'll continue with this for the rest of time. But I don't agree with that, because I think the middle class people who were following you around in Oxford have a limited attention span as a result of their upbringing, and they probably will get bored with it. Either by the time the summer ends because the weather won't be very nice, or just because they've got something better to do.
Well, my theory is different from yours. I think that the government that we have now has pretty much done to itself what John Major did over the exchange rate mechanism in 1992.
Yeah.
But people don't realise it yet because the economic consequences have yet to kick in. When they do kick in, and when an awful lot of people have lost their jobs, and when life has become a great deal harder for pretty much all of us, then the revenge will come. And this will, actually rather illogically, probably sweep into power a new Labour government, headed by Keir Starmer, who's...
God help us.
Well, you may say that, and let us hope that he will, but I think it's very likely. Especially, as I say, once a lot of people lose their jobs and associate it with a government which has not distinguished itself.
Mm.
I think you'll agree.
Well, I do agree at this moment in time. I absolutely do agree with you. I still maintain that...
I have no time for him, but he's managed to distance himself from that.
No, I think that's true, but I think it's a sort of a con trick that he's playing on everybody, which was partially exposed last Wednesday in Prime Minister's Questions when he was unable to say what he thought about schools. And I can only assume that he can't say what he thinks because he's going to upset somebody, and he seems to worry about that an awful lot. But I was talking to John Rentall earlier this morning, Peter, and I'd be interested in what you have to say about this. He said, we were talking about the whole U-turn business with free school meals and all of that, and he said, but it was the right thing to do. And I worry that that is now the phrase which we are being governed by. It's the right thing to do. And of course, for one person, the right thing to do is very different from what other people may think.
Well, it's true. But what you know when you start, that there are some things against which you cannot argue. And this is what was happening in the late years again of John Major, which is, a lot of this reminds me of, only with knobs on. And Blair himself was an obvious, well, how should I put it, obviously not very impressive. There was one occasion when he was approached by reporters to give a comment about a transport strike.
Mm.
And he was so unable to answer the question, he was so afraid of either offending the unions or offending the public, that he turned around and ran away. And Keir Starmer was in the same position,
yeah,
over the schools when Prime Minister's Questions. But it had no effect.
Mm.
Everybody was so sick of the Major government that it
yes.
didn't matter. Blair could do practically anything. He even got away with the Formula One thing in his first months in government. He
sure.
could do practically anything and nobody would mind. The problem is that the Starmer government, when it comes into office, which I think it will be as free as the air to do what it likes. And a lot of the things that it will do will be to take this country much, much further to the left than it's ever been before. And all the old forces of conservatism that Blair was afraid of, probably wrongly because they were crumbling and feeble at the time he came in, they won't be able to stop it. This will be New Labour on speed.
Well, the thing that I would say...
That's what I'm really afraid of. The
yeah.
political correctness, the wokeness of government will be hugely magnified.
No, it will, no question. But I think one of the reasons why Tony Blair succeeded in the election and got such a landslide was because not only were people fed up with John Major, they were fed up with what was being described really as old-fashioned politics. And when Tony Blair came in, it did seem like a breath of fresh air. It did seem like a new beginning. It almost, you know, until we found out that all those people lining the streets were actually paid to be there, you know, we actually believed it at the time that, you know, here's a young guy with young children in Downing Street. And it was a kind of a Kennedy-esque renaissance, wasn't it?
No, you speak for yourself in that.
I'm talking about the mood of the nation, Peter.
I knew that demonstration was phony as soon as I saw it.
Right.
I knew you couldn't get into Downing Street without official permission. And I knew all those people waving Union Jacks would much rather be waving red flags anyway. They'd obviously been told what to do.
Right.
And I'd known Blair since before he was famous. And I knew what manner of person he was. So but it was useless in my usual Cassandra role of saying to people, no, honestly, please, it's all the time.
Do you get tired of this?
I do get tired of it, because if only anybody had paid attention to me, we would actually now be a lot better off.
Yes.
Well, you didn't frankly have the balls to put country before party.